My role today is to just give you a little bit of a brief snapshot around the history of the Peace and Understanding lecture, and then I'll introduce Michael, who will introduce Eddie, who's the main person for our gig this afternoon. In the early days, and we're talking about sort of 1955 to 65, International House presented a public lecture on the theme of world peace and understanding. In 67, the lecture commenced with the hosting of a seminar on the theme, Australia and Asia, and in 68, somewhere east of Suez, the effects of British withdrawal. For 1970, the theme chosen was Man International. So even in the early days, a diverse range of topics is set within the historical and political context of the time. The notable speakers included James Killen MP, Professor Gordon Greenwood, Sir Zelman Cowan, and I'm sure some of you will know those names. The seminar and lecture was discontinued until 1988, and then recommenced with the help of Rotary International, which celebrates its World Understanding and Peace Day on the 23rd of February. The lecture in 88 was presented by Sir Harry Gibbs, former Chief Judge of the High Court, under the title Brotherhood by Example or Decree. In 89, it was presented by Dr. Ian Lowe, Commissioner for the Future, with the theme Internationalisation, the Environmental Imperative. In the intervening years, International House's Peace and Understanding lecture has attracted such guest speakers as Sir Harry Gibbs, Archbishop Peter Hollingworth, Justice Michael Kirby, Penelope Winsley AO, and Kevin Rudd, and has covered a range of globally topical issues to promote awareness of world situations. Traditionally, the lecture was held at Sir Abel Smith over at UQ, but in more recent times, it has moved back to IH, its former home, and I think a fitting place to be. I wrote this a few days ago, and the question for me was, is peace and understanding as a topic theme relevant in 2015, as it was in 1965 when it started? And given the weekend, definitely. I think as an organisation, we can make a contribution to peace. And it's not just by the lecture and the stories we tell, but by actually living it. To live peace and understanding will actually bring harmony throughout the world. And you're going to hear an absolutely awesome and amazing story very soon. And I'd like Michael, our ICC president for this year, our senior resident and president of NORC, to introduce our guest speaker this afternoon, Michael.
Good afternoon, everyone. For those of you I haven't met, my name is Michael, as Carl said. I am a current resident at the International House. And before I introduce our guest speaker today, I'd just like to extend a warm welcome everyone to our lovely dining hall. Thank you to everyone for coming. I think we can all appreciate that a little bit more peace and understanding in the world is something that's needed. Our guest speaker today is without a doubt the most inspiring man I've ever met in my life. A shining example to people everywhere, I guess, has seen the worst of humanity, not only surviving through the Holocaust, but also escaping two concentration camps in the process. He has managed to continue living a life full of love and free of hatred, even though all that's happened in the past. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my absolute honour and pleasure to introduce to you today a true inspiration to society everywhere, and someone I'm truly honoured to be able to call a friend. Please make a warm welcome to Mr. Eddie Jaku.
Good afternoon, my new young friends. I call you my friends because I hope that when I leave here today, you all call me your friends. I'm the lucky one. I got a wife. I come from Germany. I used to live in the most civilized, most cultured, and certainly the most educated country in Europe. And all my life, I ask why. I never thought what happened to me could happen in a country like Germany. My family tree goes back 400 years. I lost in the First World War two uncles and a grandfather fighting for Germany. I stand in front of you as a witness and a survivor of the most tragic time in the history of mankind. I cannot change the past. We say in French, l'union fait la force. Together we are strong, alone we are nothing. And so I appeal on you, together my aim is to make this world a better place. For this, I need all your help. In 1933, I was 13 and a half years old. I was kicked out of school called Leibniz Gymnasium. My father went to that school, my grandfather. Why? My father made me false papers. I became Walter Schleif, and I lived for 5.5 years, 860 kilometers from my city. Never be able to go home. No one knew that I was Jewish. If somebody in the shower of these 700 students would see my bottom, I'd be dead. You have no idea, young people, how lucky you are to live in Australia. I had to watch for my food, my health, my clothes, and that somebody find out I'm not Walter Schleif. I'm not the orphan. I have lovely parents. And I made it. I became a precision engineer. I make surgical instruments. I beg you to put as much as possible in your little head. It might not only shape your life, it might even save your life. Because that's what happened to me. The German needed me. In Auschwitz, where I had this number from on my arm, I had a little band. In German is wirtschaftlich wertvoller Jude, and in English is economical indispensable Jew. But you don't know what that means, because I don't know. I'm 96 years soon, and all my life I ask why. I want to teach you. Never do to anyone what you don't want to have done to you. I don't like everybody, but I hate no one. Not even the German who done that to me. We cannot change, as I said before, what has passed. But we can change the future. Please, I won't be here forever. You becoming today, all of you, my ambassadors. When you heard Eddie Jaku has left this planet, you can study. Next year I'm going to have a film which I gladly will send to you. And this is my life. I'm the happiest and luckiest man. I sing every morning in the shower. Even my wife says, shut up. When you have trouble, think of me, and your trouble will be like that. No more. You don't know what that means. I worked for Siemens, making X-ray equipment, and for Carl Zeiss, making optical. I make endoscopy, and here from the other side too. I make wonderful machines. I love my trade, and I tell all your students, fall in love what you do, because what you love doing, you will do well. What you don't like doing, perfect does not exist. Like I said to a few people, I could live with any woman, because I believe every woman is made half good and half bad. And if you fall in love, you cultivate the good part and you push away the bad. Perfect does not exist. I'm going to be married 70 years soon with the same woman. Sometimes she's really naughty because she's Greek and she's hot-blooded. So she shouts to me. I don't answer. Any imbecile can answer. Only the smart one don't answer. Then 2 hours later she rings me on my mobile and she says, Eddie, why did I shout at you? I say, I don't know. It's wonderful to be alive. I told you, the film which coming from Germany will call The Happiest and Luckiest Man, Eddie Jaku. Just to give you an idea, I worked from 7 o'clock till 3:30, then back to the school, have something to eat, and from 4:30 to 9 o'clock is everyday school, and not school like here. No mucking around, because every year you pass an exam, and if you're not up to standard, you're out. So it's very hard. To ring my parents, I had to go in the city, a small town called Stuttlingen in Bavaria, and I would go in a David Jones in a warehouse, go to the 8th floor, movement one across the street, sometimes 4 times before I was sure that no one follows me. And then in a dark corner behind the curtain, there was a telephone, and I would ring my lovely parents. I swear to you, it was more crying than talking. And my father used to say to me, Eddie, I know it's hard, but one day you'll be very, very grateful. I am. I swear to you, if I would have come from home to any of the camps that I have been, I wouldn't last 3 months. But if I had 5.5 years, the hardship, that made me, it gave me more stamina to survive the most horrible things you can imagine. You can't imagine what happened to me and what I had to witness. I made the biggest mistake of my young life. I wanted to surprise my parents on the 10th of November, 1938. I was 18 and a half years old. I bought myself a ticket and I made the 9-hour train trip from Tuttlingen to Leipzig, where I'm born. I came home on a Friday afternoon at 5:30. Lucky I had the key, otherwise I would sleep in the gutter. No one was home. I didn't know what happened. I had no time in the boarding school to listen to music or to news or read newspapers. My family was not there. Big house, 400-year-old house, where my great-great-grandparents. I was a very proud young German. I thought this was the best civilization could give to a young man like me. How wrong I was. When I opened the door, there was my dog. I had a dachshund. His name was Lulu, L-U-L-U. He recognized me. He jumped on me. He licked me. He was happy. At 12:30, I went to bed with the dog on the bottom. At 5 o'clock on the 10th of November, 10 of the Nazis broke in the door of our house, and I swear to you, they bashed me to pieces. My pajama was full of blood. I said, Eddie, this is your last day. Today you're going to die. One of the Nazis took out his bayonet of his pouch, cut the sleeve of my pyjama on my left side, pulled it off, and started to engrave a swastika in my skin. And as the blood was running down to my fingers, my little dog saw the blood. I don't know if he bit him, he jumped on him, or he just scared him. He let me go, put his bayonet on his rifle, and killed my dog, shouting, "Ein Judenhund," a Jewish dog. Now these were not 16-18-year-old hoodlums who were snatching ladies' handbags. These were educated professionals, married men with children. I lived in a society of Goethe and Schiller, of Beethoven and Mozart. How is it possible that humans can behave like animals without the same reason? Because wild animals kill only for food. Humans should be different. We can talk. Even if you don't agree with me, you are still my friend. I like people who don't agree with me. Because in French we say, a critique est un service. By critic we learn. A critic is not an offense. If somebody can show me how to make surgical instruments better and faster, I will take my hat off. So, I went to my first concentration camp, Buchenwald. 11,000 Jewish men went into this camp on the 10th of November 1938. We were in a big tent, two times as big as this hall, in a tent. We were lying on the floor. 1,423 of them were married to Christian women. And those lovely women went to Berlin. Kurfürstendamm is the main street of Berlin. And for 2 months, they marched up and down and shouted, "Let our husbands out." They let them out, but nobody done for us. From the 11,000, I can tell you, there were scientists, lawyers, doctors, professors, musicians, teachers, me. Why? Our toilet was a big hole in the ground, like this hall, with two trees across, and 25 of us sitting there doing their business, and no paper to wipe your backside. I cut my sleeve. Suddenly I had a sleeveless shirt because I made 4 eggs. And every night I sneaked out of the tent to a small creek about 30-40 meters away to wash my legs for the next day. I saw people never touch the food. The food was delivered in a big bowl. When I came to this lovely country 65 years ago, every house had a laundry with a copper, big copper, to wash, to boil your washing. In such a tin, our food was delivered. No spoon, no dish, only in your hand. Nowhere to sit. I said to the fellow next to me, "Fill him up and eat like a pig." All my clothes was dirty from the food. When I finished, I fill up his. Why? All my life I ask why. And so I repeat, please don't you do to anyone what you don't want to have done to you. If you want to stay in a civilized society, remove everyone who teaches hate. You are allowed to say, "I don't like those people." but you must never hate. Please teach your children, teach your adults, teach your parents. You must not hate. I am a survivor and I don't hate. My wife, she wasn't in the camp. She hated the German. I don't. I give the German who come to the Jewish Museum in Sydney twice in a month, in a year. I go to a German school in Sydney and I conduct my interview, my story in German. I don't hate. I'm glad and grateful to be alive. And this is important. Life is in your hands. Don't blame no one for your downfall. I keep repeating it. Happiness does not fall from the sky. It's in your hands. You have to provide it. And if I can do it, you can do it. This is important. You know, we say in French, and you say the same, shared pleasure is double pleasure. Shared sorrow is half sorrow. And this is very important. This is why I couldn't live alone. Alone should be a stone. For the last 20 years, I go to a retirement village and I visit people who don't get visitors. And I pity them. My grandmother, my mom was from 13 children, 7 girls and 6 boys. And she used to say to me, a mother can look after 10 children, but 10 children can't look after one mom. And that is the tragedy of the human race. So, what do you think? How did I get out? Some mornings they opened the gates and let 200, 300, 400 people go. And when they are 40 or 50 meters, the machine gun start shooting. And they all shot in the back. And then they put the body in a bag with a letter sent to the family. Your father or your son or your brother or your uncle have tried to escape, so we shot them. What bastards. I could have gone, but I know the German. I learned, I know them better than themselves and better than my hand. And this is how I lived. Preserve your health. In Auschwitz, we got to work, and we worked very hard. When I come back to my block, I lie down. 300, we are 400 people in a block. 399 people running around, looking for food they never find. Looking for friends or family they might find. But they're wasting irreplaceable energy. 1 hour rest is 2 days survival in Auschwitz. Me, I'm alone in the block. Fantastic. In Buchenwald, I met a man who was with me in boarding school. He was not very bright, and I helped him a lot. And he was an aristocrat. He was a descendant of the Kaiser. His name was Hans von Gaggenau. He was living in a castle. And he became a god. And when he came to us, to Buchenwald, he called me Walter. And I said, Hans, you became a god? I spit on his shoes. He trembled like this. He did not believe that I'm Jewish, because he knows what they do to me. He was so sorry that he said, Eddie, I get you out. Without asking me, he went to the commander and he told the commander, there is a man downstairs, Eddie Jaku. He is ready to work for us till the rest of his life. He is an engineer, a toolmaker, and they needed toolmakers. They called me in the office and they said, is it true what Hans told? Sign. I signed, and now you see the funny part of the German. Instead of taking me from this factory, from this camp to the factory, they called my father and they said, Mr. Jaku, your son Lenin is going to be released on the 2nd of May 1939. Pick him up at 7 o'clock in the morning. Take him home so he spent a few hours with his mom. And then you take him 40 kilometers to Bleichert, a factory who makes aeroplanes and rockets. My father picked me up, but didn't take me home. He came in a hired car, not in his car. He did not open his mouth for 9 hours. He locked the car and drove. I said, Dad, where are we going? It's not the way home, it's not the way to the factory. Stumm, he didn't answer. And we arrived at the evening at a city called Aachen, that is the border town between Belgium and Germany. We went to a restaurant, we had a lovely meal, and while we were eating, my father got up and started asking the owner for the phone number of a smuggler who can take us in the night to Belgium. The smuggler came at 12 o'clock at night. It took 4 hours through Holland. We went through Holland to a big forest, and we arrived in Belgium the next morning. And for 2 weeks, I was free with my father, living in a very nice apartment. And then a knock on the door, Belgian police. And I was arrested with handcuffs, not as a Jew, as a German. Mm-hmm. Now, can you imagine? In Germany, I'm not German, I'm Jewish. But in Belgium, I'm not Jewish, I'm German. And I'm an enemy. You can't understand. It can't be. So, I was in a camp there. We haven't got the time that I give you all the camps. But you will be able, on computer, you have all my story. I spent nearly 1 year in Belgium in a camp with 4,000 Germans. Communist, socialist, democrat, homosexual, gypsy, retarded people. And I spoke French. I made an application to the Belgian government and they gave me permission to travel every day. 5 to 7, I had to take a train. It was a seat for me, Eddie. We have in Belgium and in every country in Europe, we have identity cards. I had to go to the police, stamp the card, and then the train would take me to a city called Scan in French, or Ghent, and I went to university. It helped me a lot. One day only, I missed the train. Why? When I went at 7 o'clock, 6:45 to the police station, the policeman was on the toilet, and when he came back, it was too late. The train is gone and can't take another train. On the 10th of May, 1940, Hitler invaded Norway, Denmark, Holland, Belgium, France. And World War II. My camp was liquidated, and I walked through the French countryside. First we went to Dunkirk, there was a big battle, and the British were defeated. There were no Australians, only Canadian and French, and they were defeated, and there were thousands of British soldiers dead. And with me was a man, his name was Monsieur Hertel. He was foreign minister before Hitler in the Hindenburg government. And I saw him taking the uniform of a dead British soldiers, put it on, and walked on a British warship. So I thought, Eddie, you can do that too. I spoke English, so I looked for a fellow my size, so that my trousers are not like this, and I found one. And when I wanted to take his trousers off, I couldn't. He must have had a bomb or a bullet in his back, and all his intestine went into his trousers, and I couldn't do it. I walked for 2.5 months through the countryside of France. I must tell you that the French farmers are wonderful people. I never had to beg or steal food. Every morning at sunrise, I would pass a farmhouse. A lady or a man would come out and shout, "Tu as mangé hier? Did you eat yesterday?" "No, come in." They never asked my name. They never asked where I come from or where I'm going. I found this wonderful. I didn't have to go to a toilet because I could go anywhere. But I came to a big city called Lyon. And in France, we have no male and female toilet. You all go to the same toilet. It's a big toilet block. A woman is sitting there, elderly. Now she's young. But for me, it was elderly then when I was 22. And you must pay her 1 franc. She gives you a towel so that you wash your head before and after. And if you have a jacket, she hangs it on the coat hanger. And she tells you in which cubicle she wants you to go. I sit down. It didn't take 2 minutes. The door opened. French ladies coming to the toilet, pulling me off with my trousers down, started punching me and shouting, "Parachutist." The German had lots of spies all over Europe, speaking the language, because the bombers had visualized bombing. They didn't have laser like today. So if the bomb fell 20 meters from the building, they said, there was a spy. And he would speak on two-way radio with a special frequency to the pilot, Hans or Fritz, "Come back, you idiot. You missed the building by 20, 30, 40 meters." They took me for a spy. I was in another camp. This camp was called Gurs, G-U-R-S. There I couldn't go to work. It was not a bad camp, but was a French camp. I didn't even know that there was another Jew, because I didn't go around in the shower and look who is circumcised. So I didn't know there was, we speak German, we spoke German. I was there for 11 months. In February 1941, my name was called. I went and we were loaded. I found out in the 7,000 prisoners, where 823 were German Jews. Hitler made a deal with Laval. He was Prime Minister of France, and he was a collaborator. He told him, "Give me all the German Jews. I need workers, and they are all highly educated and professionals, and I give you thousands and thousands of French prisoners." And we were exchanged. And we were loaded 35 people in a wagon. I asked the train driver in French, "How long this train will travel in France before it enters Germany?" He told me 9 hours. So I had 9 hours to get out. On each French train, you find on the platform a hammer, a screwdriver, and a shifting spanner. I took that off, put it under my jacket, and as the train was going, I unscrewed all the bolts off the floor and chased them out. I didn't know a floorboard is not made like that. A floorboard has a tongue and the other has a groove. It's interlocked. If you live in a house, that's how it's made. It took me 10 hours to chisel away one tongue, and eventually, it was already well in the night. I opened 2 planks and 9 of us from the 35, we could go in like that, turn around, and we are already with the feet on the floor and we're waiting. And suddenly I saw big lights, and that was Strasbourg station. I said, "Now," we fall down, we put our head, because sometimes a cable or a chain is hanging down, that hits you here in the middle, you're dead. The train went to Auschwitz, but without me. Ask me again. Now the train runs in Germany and in Europe on the right side. And I stayed outside the station on the left side. I can't come on the first plane and not on the second, but on the third. I jump on the coming when the train is not going too fast. I jump on, I stay on the platform. Every time a train goes in a station, I have to jump off, even if I break my legs. And so I went back, eventually I come back to Belgium. I couldn't find my parents and my sister. They left their lovely apartment and they went into an old gentleman, not as old as me, but old. And they paid him some money and then let him live. He let them live in the Arctic. I worked for a cigarette factory. The man had 7 children. He said, Eddie, I need a person to repair my cigarette machines and I'll pay you in cigarettes. Cigarettes were 10 times the price of a normal packet. So I say, okay. But he says, before I give you the job, I want you to swear on the Bible. I'm going to put a little capsule on your collar. If you're caught in the night from 10 to 5, there's no one in the street, only firemen, police and army. If you're caught going home at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, if they catch you, you tell them where you work, and they kill me and my family. You press this capsule, a little tablet will fall out. You put that in your mouth, and within 30 seconds, you are dead. I swear to you, if I was caught, that's what I would have done. But I was never caught. Hallelujah. But one night, if I take my trousers off, you will see a beautiful red mark, one this and like that, half and half. I heard a car coming. No lights, they had no lights. And I run into a doorway, and I tell you, a big dog bit me and took out a little piece. And as I couldn't go to a hospital or to a doctor, I went the next morning to a pharmacy and I bought myself a tetanus and a little needle, and I gave myself a tetanus injection. It's so beautiful to see you all and be alive. I want you to remember me like that. A happy man. Not a problem. And this is why I say, the most important things in life is tolerance, understanding, and friendship. My best friend is 172,333. He died last November. Mine is 172,338. Without him, I wouldn't be here. And without me, he wouldn't have lived till last year. He was 2 years younger than me. He lived in Israel. Every 5 years, I was meeting him, my 3 sisters, which I saved from committing suicides, and I'd meet 3 young Germans. Now they're old, but they were with me in camps, and they're Germans. But they were not Jewish, Christians. In 1942, I was arrested in Belgium because somebody denounced us that we are living in the Arctic. And we were sent to Auschwitz. 150 people in a wagon. Men, women and children. No one can lie down. You stand or you kneel. You stand or kneel. And we get one bucket of water and one bucket is the toilet. My father, a stubborn German, he said, I'm going to sleep next to the water. I have 2 products in my pocket from Switzerland. One was a pouch, inside was a cup. The cup you pull up, it's a cup. You put it down, it's about that thing. Any other knife comes in white or red with a cross. It's got scissors, screwdriver, bottle opener, corkscrew, pinpoint, a fire for your night, my father had. And he said to the people, I give you one cup of water in the morning and one small piece of newspaper. In the evening, you give me back the newspaper, you get another cup of water. Thanks to my dad, no one died in my wagon. In the other 9 wagons, 50, 60, up to 70%, they died because they were drinking water all day and all night. Our train trip from Belgium to Auschwitz was 9 days and 8 nights. And in the other 9 wagons, many people died. If you come to the museum, I show you, we have wagons there. And it says the women shouted through that little hole, water, please, water, for my gold ring, water. You can only survive 3 days without water. You can live 2 weeks without food, not without water. So we arrived in Auschwitz. How long?
Okay.
One more?
No, keep going, yeah.
Okay. You tell me. When I arrive in Auschwitz, we meet the biggest butcher and killer ever lived. His name is Dr. Joseph Mengele. He says to my father, this way, and to me, this way. I saw my father going on a truck, so I went behind him, and I was nearly at the truck when one of the stooges said, hey, you, didn't he tell you this way? And I say, well, why? Your father goes by truck and you walk into the camp. He saved my life. If I would have got on this truck, I wouldn't stand today in front of you. So sometimes it hangs on a lesson. Auschwitz, you will never understand, because I don't understand. It is a death camp. Every day you see people hanging. Every day. I walk 1.5 hours to work. I work for Bayer, B-A-Y-E-R. That's the biggest chemical factory in Europe. They are here, they make Bygon against cockroaches, they make Aspro clear. I work for them. And I worked many, many years, 2.5 years. We walk to work, in the rain, in the snow, no umbrella, no cover, no raincoat, nothing. You have no idea. I swear to you, if there is a paradise, the gates will open and say, Eddie, come in, because hell I had on earth. It is hell. Many people, we were 4 young Germans. 2 were friends and Kurt and me. My other 2 friends, one night we didn't see them. They went naked to the wire. They're holding hands. One touches with this hand, the other with the other. 30 seconds. Dead. Electrocuted. And many times when I was sick, I said to my friend, Kurt, let's go to the wire. And I went in the middle of the night, I went down to the shower and I saw a manhole. I found a ladder, I put the ladder up, I opened the manhole and 2 men say, shh, 2 fellow was hiding already. So I ran back to my friend and I said, Kurt, I found a hiding place. I kissed him, I hugged him. I thought I'd never see him again. And I put him in there, I helped him up the ladder, I closed the door, idiot me, should have been there too. And I was another 6 months with the German. My friend was liberated 2 days after by the Russian. And me back to Buchenwald. In Buchenwald I told you, I had a motto, never be the first, never be the last, and never volunteer. I had to break this. In Buchenwald, there's no escape. So the second time we are lying on the floor, a man comes in and shouts, is there a toolmaker between you? Me. and I was sent to a small camp called Sonnenberg. It's a camp of 200 people, and this time I worked in the night underground for a company called Krupp, K-R-U-P-P, biggest metal company of Germany. And I was doing gears, rectification of gears. And I had also a sign, if I make certain mistakes, I hang. And when this factory was closed up, we were 200 prisoners. We were walking around in circles. And one night, the commander said, I found a horse, I'm going to kill the horse. Everybody gets a meal. And you know that in Europe, we eat, it's not kosher, but we eat horse meat. If you're in France, you're in a hospital, you get horse meat. Horse is the cleanest animal of all animals. In France, you have boucherie chevalier. That means butchers, they sell only horse. And so if you're sick in France, in a hospital, you get horse meat. Not chicken, because chicken eat anything, not the horse. I found two pieces of timber, which was the lid of sour cucumber. The German loved sour cucumber, me too. And I found the lid of the cucumber. And I carried them with me. Every time we stop, I sit on them. So my guards don't see that I carry those timber. When it got dark that night, in Germany the road is 34 meters wide and it's 1.5 meters above the fields. And every 100 meters there is a big pipe underneath the road. It's about 95 centimeters in diameter. Normally it is half full of water. In 1945 we had a lot of rain and very cold. It was 3/4 full of water. I went right into the middle when it got dark that day that he promised us the meal. And I'm squeezed in the pipe like this. In the water was much warmer than outside. Not warm, but warmer. And I'm right in the middle. And I put one timber on my right side and one timber on my left side, touching my ears. Because I never knew what are those two people who are standing behind when we are moving away, what they do. Now I know. Because I blacked out, I lost my wooden shoes in the water. When I woke up, I don't know, after 1 or 2 days, 38 bullets were stuck in the right timber and 10 in the left. I had a premonition that those two men shoot in those pipes. Never wouldn't have. I had a mark for 1 year. One bullet nearly went through and scraped me, but didn't go through, because otherwise I would be dead. That was my luck. And I wrote something to the German about this, that I didn't know what those two men with the machine gun do. I walked out of the water, 4 o'clock in the morning, it was still dark, and I saw smoke coming out of a house. I was wet and skinny. I weighed only 30 kilos. I went to that house, I knocked on the door. A young lady of 17 opened. I said to her in good German, can you help me with a pair of shoes? I lost my shoes. It went away with the water. She knew I was Jewish. I had a little triangle on my striped clothes and it was in yellow. And she ran in, she called the father. Father came out in pyjama. He hugged me, he kissed me. And he said, please stay with me. There are no houses for 15 kilometers. No way. If the patrol car comes here, finds me in your house, they kill me and your whole family. He gave me a jumper, I threw away my striped jacket. He gave me leather shoes I didn't have for 3.5 years. He gave me a cap,
with a shield from a golf club, and I threw away my stripe. He showed me where his high shed was. I stayed one night in the high shed, and the next morning I walked 4 kilometers through a big forest. First night I went in a cave, I couldn't stay. Bats were flying around, hitting me on the head. Luckily I had no hair, because if they get into your hair, you can't get them out. The second night I was in a cave, no one would find me there. I tell you, when I came out of this cave one day, I show you, I couldn't open my eyes because I was always in the dark. For 2.5 months, Eddie was eating big snails, escargot, and slugs, the ones which have no eyes, just like that. They didn't kill me. It's the water which I collected from a small creek. This was poison. On the 4th of June, I was so sick, I couldn't stand up. I had plenty of food because I covered my snails. They go to sleep in the winter. So when I found those nests, I covered them because I didn't know how long I need them. But this water made me so sick that I couldn't stand up anymore. On my knees and my hands, I made 100 meters. It took me a full day. So weak I was. I arrived at the highway. Highway is not high. So I had to go a bit further, crawl a bit further, and pull myself up on some bushes. I put my head on the highway. I'm in front of an American tank. The war was over for a month, and I didn't know. And those lovely soldiers, I don't know where they got the blanket from. They put me on a blanket, and they drove me to a German hospital. I was in a coma for 1 week. When I woke up, I thought, Eddie, you're already going cuckoo, because I thought I was still in this cave, and today I'm in a bed with white sheets and cushions, and nurses are running around. It's not possible. It was. And I came every morning, I was very, very sick. Every morning comes a Professor Hoffman with a little beard. And I ask him every day, in the morning at 6 o'clock, at night, what are my chances? As soon as I ask, he walks away. Eventually, I grabbed the arm of a nurse. Her name was Emma. She was tall like that. And I said, Emma, I know you're not allowed to tell me, but what did he tell you? And I started crying. And she bent down and she whispered in my ear, 65% you're dead and 35% you live. And I made a vow to this man up there. I say, lieber God, dear God, if you help me to come out of this hospital alive, I promise you, I will never, ever, never put my feet again on German soil. That's what I'm doing. Thank you.